Last week we ended up dealing with the fifth main division, which has to do with the origin of demons, just where did the demons come from? And we had to deal with this question in two categories. First of all, free demons, and then secondly, confined demons. And in speaking of confined demons, we had to subdivide that into two categories. The temporarily confined demons, those who are confined in the abyss for a temporary period of time. And then we began dealing with the permanently confined demons, the ones spoken of in Genesis chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. And we concluded our discussion last week with that Genesis passage. We also mentioned that there are two corollary passages to the Genesis account in the New Testament, and we need to deal with these as well. The next passage that deals with the issue of the permanently confined demons is 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. These verses read, "For God spared not angels when they sinned, but cast them down to hell, and committed them to pits of darkness, to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not in the ancient world, but preserved Noah with seven others, a preacher of righteousness, when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly." Now, verse 4, we are told what is the place of the permanently confined demons. Now, the temporarily confined demons are found in the abyss, but the permanently confined demons are elsewhere. The Greek word translated in this passage as hell is a Greek word that means Tartarus, T-A-R-T-A-R-U-S. Tartarus is a section of Sheol or Hades, and it is the section where the permanently confined demons are at. Now, both the abyss and the area of Tartarus are sections of Sheol or Hades. The abyss is for demons that are temporarily confined, but the Tartarus is for demons that are permanently confined. Verse 4 refers to these things as pits of darkness, and we are told that they are reserved there unto the judgment. This judgment is the great white throne judgment, the final judgment. And that means that at no time will they ever be released. That's why they are permanently confined demons. When the time comes, they will go from Tartarus before the great white throne judgment and cast right into the lake of fire. There will never be a time when they will be free to roam. These are permanently confined demons. Then verse 5 tells us the timing of their confinement. It is in conjunction with the flood, and this agrees well with the events of Genesis chapter 6 verses 1 through 4, which are events that are also tied into the time of the flood. And the purpose of the flood was to destroy this product of fallen angels and human women. So at least by comparing the Peter passage with the Genesis passage, that is good evidence again to show that what Genesis is speaking about is not Sethites as over against Cainites, but fallen angels and human women. I think that's already a valid conclusion just from a study of the Old Testament passage themselves. However, the New Testament supports that particular interpretation. There is a second New Testament passage that deals with the same subject matter, and that is Jude verses 6 and 7. Verses 6 and 7 read, "And the angels that kept not their own principality, but left their own proper habitation, he had kept in everlasting bonds under darkness unto the judgment of the great day, even as Sodom and Gomorrah, and the cities about them, having in like manner with these given themselves over to fornication and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the punishment of eternal fire. Now we'll break these two verses down and see exactly what they're saying. Verse 6 emphasizes the facts of the fall of a select group of angels, and it describes the fall in four statements. Number 1, they kept not their own principality. The word principality is frequently used of the angelic realm and the various ranks and orders within the angelic realm. They kept not their own principality meant they did not remain in their position and place of rank within the satanic cosmos. But secondly, they left their proper habitation. They left the demonic angelic sphere of operation and entered into the human sphere. They entered into the human sphere by taking on the form of young men and intermarrying with human women. Thirdly, they are now kept in everlasting bonds under darkness. Here Jude mentions the same thing that Peter mentioned. They are now permanently confined. They are kept in everlasting bonds under darkness. They are permanently confined, and Peter told us the place of their confinement. The place of their confinement was Tartarus. Then fourthly, they are being kept there until the judgment of that great day. And here again, Jude reaffirms Peter. They are being kept in bondage until the judgment of that great day. This again speaks of the great white throne judgment. So once again, it is reaffirmed that these demons will never be free to roam around. They are permanently confined in Tartarus. When the time comes, they'll be taken out of Tartarus to stand immediately before the great white throne judgment and then be cast into the lake of fire. Now, while verse 6 told us the facts of their fall, verse 7 deals with the nature of their sin. And the key phrase in verse 7 is, in like manner. In like manner as Sodom and Gomorrah, they went after strange flesh. The sin that these angels committed is similar to the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, what was the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah? It was sexual sin. The sexual sin of going after strange flesh. Strange flesh means sexual union that is unnatural. It goes contrary to nature. In the case of Sodom and Gomorrah, the strange flesh was homosexuality. And the unnatural relationships that Sodomites and Gomorrites were guilty of was homosexuality. In the case of angels, the strange flesh was female flesh, because instead of remaining in the usual state of residence, they invaded a new state of residence of alien flesh to commit gross sexual immorality. So Sodom and Gomorrah and these angels have one thing in common. They are guilty of sexual sins. In the case of Sodom and Gomorrah, it's homosexuality. In the case of these angels, it is fallen angels intermarrying into the human sphere. So then, I think comparing Genesis with the passages in Peter and Jude, it is clear that these are the angels that intermarried with human women and not simply Sethites marrying Cainites. So in summarizing the origin of demons, all demons have the same basic origin. All demons have the same origin in that these are the angels who fell with Satan. However, sometime after that the angels fell with Satan, some of Satan's fallen angels eventually married into the human race. They married human women for the purpose of trying to corrupt the seed of the woman in order to try to thwart the first messianic prophecy of Genesis chapter 3 verse 15. And these particular angels that intermarried with human women are now permanently confined in Tartarus. The others are free, though periodically many of them are temporarily confined into the abyss. But that's a temporary confinement, and they are eventually released to roam free again. The difference is between receiving a temporary sentence in jail as or against a life sentence in jail. The demons of Genesis 6 have a life sentence. Others only receive a temporary sentence in our time. Eventually, of course, all will be eternally confined in the lake of fire following the great white throne judgment. We shall move on to the sixth main division, which deals with the number of demons. How many demons are there in the universe? Well, first of all, we have certain indications that they are quite a few in number. For example, in Mark chapter 5, verse 9 and verse 15, in Luke chapter 8, verse 30, mentions a legion of demons residing in one person. A legion consisted anywhere between 4,000 to 6,000 demons. So this one being mentioned in Mark and Luke had 4,000 to 6,000 demons residing in him. Secondly, in Revelation chapter 9, verse 16, we read of at least 200 million temporarily confined demons. These are the temporarily confined. They're not the only temporarily confined demons. And there's 200 million just in this one segment. It's in Revelation chapter 12, verses 3 and 4, that we discover the percentage of angels that fell with Satan. In that passage, we are told that Satan, who is the dragon, draws with him a third of the stars. Now, whenever the word star is used symbolically, it is always a symbol for an angel. A symbol for an angel. The fact that Satan draws one third of the stars tells us that of the entire body of angels, one third of all angels followed Satan in his original revolt, and so one third of the original number of angels became demons. So two thirds remained loyal to God, but one third changed their allegiance to Satan. So to conclude the question, how many demons are there? The answer is innumerable. We know from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 22 to 24, that originally there was an innumerable number of angels created. An innumerable number of angels were originally created, and one third of that original number became demons. And apparently that one third itself is quite innumerable. So there are indeed a great number of demons. The seventh part of our study has to do with the organization of demons. Demons are very well organized. They're as well organized as the good angels are. And we find this organization in a variety of passages. First of all, there is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 24, which speaks of at least three different orders in the organization of angels. And these three are rulers, authorities, and powers. A second passage is in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, which also mentions three categories of demons in the organization of demons. One of these is repeated from the Corinthian passage, and that is powers. We also have the mention of principalities and world rulers. A third passage is Colossians chapter 2, verse 15, which also mentions principalities and powers. In the Old Testament, we read of demons that function as rulers over nations. So Daniel chapter 10, verses 13 and 20 mentions the prince of the kingdom of Persia, and Daniel chapter 10, verse 20 mentions the prince of Greece. So these are the organization of angels, and what we can conclude is that the organization of demons is an imitation of the organization of the elect angels. Remember, Satan and all demons were once part of the divine order of creation, and so they were well aware of the organization of angels that God had in heaven. But in looking at these particular titles, we see that these titles of demons are the same as the titles that good angels have. So the organization of demons is an imitation of the organization of the elect angels with similar ranks and orders. Now we come to the eighth major segment of our study, which has to do with the characteristics of demons. What are the characteristics of demons? And dealing with the characteristics of demons, I want to deal with this in three categories. The first category is their nature. What is the nature of demons? And concerning the nature of demons, let me mention four things. Number one, they are spirit beings. They are spirit beings. In fact, demons and unclean spirits are clearly one and the same. And we can see this just from parallel accounts. For example, Matthew 17, verse 18 mentions a demon, but the parallel account in Mark 9, 25 mentions it to be an unclean spirit. We also find the word demon, unclean spirit, used interchangeably, as in Matthew 8, 16, Luke 9, verses 38, 39 and 42, in Luke chapter 10, verses 17 and 20. And this interchangeable use between demons and spirit, unclean spirits, shows that demons are spirit beings. Another way that we can see they are spirit beings is that a great number of them can exist in a small space. And Luke chapter 8, verse 30 speaks of a legion of demons located in one body. And furthermore, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 teaches that demons are not composed of flesh and blood. So concerning their nature, they are first of all spirit beings. The second thing about the nature of demons is that they are bodiless. They do not have physical body as we think of physical body. They can possess a physical body, but they don't have one of their own, according to Matthew 12, verses 43 to 45, and Mark 5, verse 12. The third thing about their nature is that while they are spirit beings, they do have shapes. They have clear shapes and features, and these features are frequently animal-like features. And we see this in Revelation chapter 9, verses 7 through 10 and verses 17 through 19. Also Revelation chapter 16, verses 13 and 14. And the fourth thing about the nature of demons is that they seek to possess men, since to some extent their power is dependent upon their possessing of men. And this we see in Mark chapter 5, verses 1 through 13, Acts 16, 16, and Acts 19, verse 16. The second category concerning the characteristics of demons is to talk about their power. And concerning their power, let me mention four things. Number one, they have the power to control men from within, as we see in Mark 5, verses 1 through 5, and Acts 19, verse 16. Secondly, they can afflict men, as we see them doing in Revelation 9, verses 1 through 21, where in the Great Tribulation they will afflict the unbelievers for 5 months. Thirdly, demons can perform miracles, as we see them during Revelation 16, verse 14. And fourthly, they have the ability to appear visibly, and we see this in Revelation 9, verses 7 through 10, and verses 17 through 19, also in Revelation 16, verses 13 through 14. The third category in discussing the characteristics of demons concerns their morality. And here let me mention 9 things about their morality, the moral state. Number 1, they are called unclean spirits, so they are in their morality unclean. Their uncleanness is seen in Matthew 10 verse 1, Mark chapter 1 verses 23 and 27, chapter 3 verse 11, chapter 5 verse 2, chapter 9 verse 25. Also Luke 4 verse 36, Acts 8 verse 7, and Revelation 16 verse 13. The second thing about their morality is that they are also evil spirits. They are corrupt in their nature, in Luke 7, verse 21. Thirdly, they are fierce and vicious, as they are described in Matthew 8, verse 28. And fourthly, they're also vile and malicious, in Luke 9, verse 39. Fifthly, they are characterized by extreme viciousness, in Mark 9, verse 20. Sixthly, they do have a counterfeit system of doctrine, according to 1 Timothy 4, verses 1 through 3, and this counterfeit system of doctrine has at least 6 main points. Number 1, apostasy from the faith. Secondly, giving in to seduction. Thirdly, living a life of hypocrisy. Fourthly, having a lying tongue. Fifthly, a loss of the exercise of conscience. And sixthly, a denial of Christian liberty in the areas of marriage and eating. Seventhly, their immorality leads to further immorality in Luke 8 verse 27, and so demonism will lead to immorality. Occult practices will lead to immorality. Eighth, they are described as being part of this darkness controlled by Satan in Ephesians 6 verse 12. And ninth, they are not all equally wicked. There are degrees of wickedness even among demons, as we see in Matthew 12 verses 43 to 45. We now come to the ninth segment, which has to do with the activities of demons. What do demons do? And let me divide this study of the activities of demons into 4 categories. The first category has to do with historical activities, in that demonic activity increases and decreases at certain periods of times. First of all, we should observe that throughout the Old Testament, there is very little demonic activity recorded. Throughout the whole history of the Old Testament, there is rare cases of demonic activity recorded. But then secondly, when we move into the gospel history, we are suddenly inundated with demonic activity. All of a sudden, we see demons everywhere throughout the gospels. Everywhere that Jesus goes, he is confronted with demons. The reason for this is spelled out by Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 through 5, which tells us that during the first coming of Jesus, while he was here on earth, Satan had his entire demonic cohorts brought down from their present abode, which is the atmospheric heavens, and brought them down to the earth. But not just to the earth in general, but into the area of the Middle East, and particularly in the land of Israel. And so it appears that the vast majority of demons, maybe all of the demons, was I believe all of the demons were within the Middle East area, and the majority of these were in the land of Israel during the first coming of Jesus. And the reason why Satan had all of his demons come into this territory was to try to thwart the purpose of the first coming. And so Satan is down there moving events or moving people to try to do something to keep Christ from the cross by having him killed either prematurely, such as the slaughter of the babes in Bethlehem, or in a wrong manner, such as by sword or by stoning. So for this reason, there is heavy, tremendous heavy demonic activity in the Gospels, because Satan has brought down his entire demonic cohort to the earth. Then thirdly, as we move on to the book of Acts and later history, we again are reduced to the level that it was in the Old Testament. Demonic activity is on the reduction in the book of Acts and in subsequent history. But then fourthly, we find that in the future, in the Great Tribulation, there will be once again heavy demonic activity. As you read through the book of Revelation, we find demons mentioned rather frequently, and it seems that the demonic activity is back up into the level that it was in the gospel stage, and indeed it will be for a similar purpose. The reason there was tremendous activity of demons in the gospels was to try to thwart the purpose of the first coming. Now, in the Great Tribulation, there'll be tremendous demonic activity to try to thwart the purpose of the second coming. The second coming will not occur till the Jewish people ask Jesus to return. We have stressed this point many times in our broadcast. And Satan, knowing this, in the Great Tribulation, will bring all of his demons down to move the entire world to turn against the Jews, to try to annihilate the Jews once and for all, before they have a chance to plead for the Messiah to return. And if Satan can ever succeed in destroying all the Jews before there is a national regeneration of Israel, then there'll be no second coming, and Satan's career is eternally safe. And for that reason, there will be an increase in demonic activity in the Great Tribulation. So basically, the history of demonic activity can be divided into four eras. Number one, there was little activity from Genesis until the Gospel. Secondly, during the Gospel history, there is tremendous activity. Then thirdly, from Acts until the Tribulation, again, demonic activity is reduced. And then fourthly, there'll come the period of the Great Tribulation, which will once again have a tremendous increase in demonic activity. The second category in discussing the activities of demons is to deal with some general activities of demons. And there are three main things that demons do in a general way. The first general activity of demons is to thwart the purpose of God. To thwart the purpose of God. This we see, for example, in Daniel chapter 10, verses 10 through 14, where we read how a leading demon was able to hold an angel of God captive for 3 weeks. And the reason was to thwart God's purpose of giving Daniel revelation of things to come. Another example of this first general activity is found in Revelation chapter 16, verses 12 to 16, where demons aid in the gathering of the nations for Armageddon, and the reason for this gathering is to thwart God's purpose for the second coming. The first general activity, then, is to thwart the purpose of God. A second general activity is to extend Satan's authority by doing his bidding. They extend the satanic authority over his cosmos by doing his bidding, as we see them doing in Ephesians 2 verses 1 and 2 and Ephesians 6 verses 11 and 12. The third general demonic activity is that demons can and are used by God to carry out His own purposes, and God does use demons at times to carry out His own plan and will. So, for example, in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 14, a demon was used to torment Saul. In 1 Kings 22, verses 19 through 23, a lying demon was used to arrange for the death of Ahab. And in 2 Corinthians 12, verse 7, a demon was allowed to be used to keep Paul humble. God will use demons to carry out His own purposes. So these are the general activities of demons. The third category of activities of demons has to do with their particular or specific activities. And here I would like to mention third specific activities. Number one, angels are related, demons, that is, fallen angels, are related to the control of nations. Just as God has good angels controlling nations, Satan has evil angels controlling nations. So Daniel 10, verses 10 through 14, speaks of the demonic prince of Persia, and Daniel 10, verses 20 and 21, speaks of the demonic prince of Greece. Secondly, demons can and do inflict physical maladies. And we see several categories of these in the scriptures. For instance, a demon can inflict dumbness or muteness. In Matthew 9, 32 and 33, and Matthew 12, 22, and Mark 9, verse 17. Secondly, they inflict deafness in Mark 9, 25. Thirdly, they can cause curvature of the spine in Luke 9, verses 12 through 16. Fourthly, they can cause epilepsy in Matthew 17, verses 15 through 18, Mark 9, 20, and Luke 9, verses 37 through 42. Fifthly, they can inflict blindness in Matthew 12, 22, and sixthly, they can cause personal injury in Mark 9, 18. So secondly, then, demons can inflict physical maladies, but not all physical maladies are caused by demons. And there is a distinction between physical problems caused by human frailty as over against those caused by demons. And you'll find this in Matthew 4:24 and Matthew 8:16. A third particular activity is that demons can cause insanity, as they do in Mark 5 verses 1 through 5 and Luke 8 verses 26 and 27. Fourthly, they can give great physical strength, as they do in Mark 5 verses 1 through 4 and Luke 8 verse 29. Fifthly, they can cause suicide, as they do in Mark 9 verse 22. Sixthly, demons can even possess animals, as they do in Mark 5, verses 12 and 13. Seventhly, demons do promote idolatry, as we see them doing Leviticus 17, verse 7, Isaiah 65, verse 11, Deuteronomy 32, verse 17, Zechariah 13, verse 2, Hosea chapter 4, verse 12, Acts 17, verse 22, and 1 Corinthians 10, verse 20. Eighth, they can cause men to worship demons in Revelation 9, verses 20 and 21. Ninth, demons do cause impurity and immorality, as they do in Luke 8, verse 27. Tenth, demons promote false doctrine, as they do in 1 Timothy 4, verse 11, and James 3, verse 15, and 1 John chapter 4, verse 1. 11, they oppose the spiritual growth of believers in Ephesians 6, 12. And 12, they attempt to separate believers from the love of God in Romans 8, 38. The 13th activity is that they can control men from within, but that is something we shall study in a totally different context, and so We will not go into it at this time. For this broadcast, we move on to the fourth category concerning the activities of demons, and that is to discuss the activities of demons in relationship to the occult, activities related to the occult world. And this too is an extensive subdivision, and so we're going to discuss the activities of demons in relationship to the occult in 6 points. Number one, let's first of all talk about certain Greek words which connect demonism with the world of the occult, and there are three key words we need to be concerned about. The first key word is deisidaimonia. Deisidaimonia is spelled deisidaimonia, which means a reverence of demonic things. A reverence of demonic things. And this word is found in Acts 25, verse 19. The second Greek word that relates demonism to the occult world is the Greek word deisidaimonesteros. And deisidaimonesteros is spelled deisidaimonesteros, which means a reverence for demons. The previous was a reverence for demonic things, like occult objects, but the second thing tells us what's behind it, and that is a reverence of demons themselves. And this word is found in Acts 17, verse 22. The third main Greek word that we need to be concerned about is the word daimoniotes. And daimoniotes is spelled daimoniotes, and it's a Greek word that literally means demonic things, such as occultic things. Demonic things, that word is used in James 3, verse 15. Now, based upon these three Greek words, we can derive to a basic meaning as to what the occult is. What do we mean by the term occult? Number one, occult means things which are covered over. Things which are covered over. Secondly, the occult is things which are hidden and concealed. Thirdly, occult is things which are secret. And fourthly, occult are things which are mysterious. So these four things kind of help define what occult is. Things which are covered over, hidden and concealed, secret and mysterious. So occult practice is an attempt to go beyond the five senses in order to gain hidden knowledge and understanding. That is what occultism is. It is an attempt to go beyond the five senses in order to gain hidden knowledge and understanding. The second thing about occult world and demonic activities is to deal with the facets of the occult. And dealing with the various facets of the occult, we need to consider three passages of scripture. The first passage is Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 9 through 14, which mentions eight different facets of the occult world or occultism. Number one, it mentions divination. And divination here means fortune-telling by magical means. Secondly, it mentions augury, which is soothsaying, which is trying to determine the future by reading the entrails of animals. Thirdly, Moses mentions the enchanter. This is the magician who puts others under the demonic spell or under the demonic control. Fourthly, he mentions sorcerer, which refers to witches and witchcraft, and also includes the area of astrology. Fifthly, he mentions charmer. The charmer is the one that practices magic miracles, incantations, and hypnotism. Sixthly, Moses mentions the consulter, with a familiar spirit. The consultant with a familiar spirit refers to the medium who is controlled by a demon. The medium that is controlled by a demon. It is called familiar probably because this was the demon that had been assigned to a person that has now passed away. And because this demon has observed this person all of his life, he knows the secrets and he knows how to imitate the person well and is able to pretend that he is the spirit of that dead person when he is no such thing. The seventh facet is the wizard. This is the clairvoyant or the psychic person. The word wizard is a masculine witch. The eighth facet is the necromancer, which is the medium that consults the dead. And these are the eight facets of the occult world that is mentioned by Moses. The second passage is Acts 8 verse 9, which mentions sorcery, and Acts 16 verse 16, which mentions divination. It's interesting that the Greek word translated as divination literally reads the spirit of a python, the spirit of a python, and the python is a snake. And of course, the snake in scripture is connected with Satan. And so he is the ultimate source of all occultism, and demons and occultism work hand in hand. In fact, one would not exist without the other. If there were no demons, there would be no occult. You could have demons without a cult, of course, but there would be no occult practice without the existence of demons. Now, the third thing to deal with is the characteristics of occultism. What are the characteristics of the occult? And here let me mention six specific characteristics. Number one, occultism always involves some contact with the demonic world. There's always some contact with the world of demons. And this is seen from the fact that in Greek, the root word demon, in every case where you have occult practices, the root word goes back to demons. And the various facets of occult world all are connected with demonic activity. So first of all, occultism always involves some contact with the demonic world. Secondly, occultism involves the uncovering of hidden knowledge of the past or future. Occultism involves the uncovering, the unveiling of hidden knowledge of the past or future. And this we saw from defining what occultism is based upon those three Greek words. Thirdly, occultism makes promises of extra powers. And this is what attracts people to the occult world. Occultism does make promises of extra powers. It makes promises of mental powers, the ability to control other people. It also promises the powers of miracles. And this is one of its attracting features. The fourth characteristic of occultism is that occultism can lead to the passing on of demonic control to the third and fourth generation. Occultism can lead to the passing on of demonic control to the third and fourth generation, according to Exodus 20, verses 3 through 5. Now that point is a deduction, because the sin that is passed on to third and fourth generation is that of the worship of another god. And in the context of that passage, God warns that if they worship any other gods, like idolatry, he will punish them. He will visit the iniquity upon the children and children's children to the third and to the fourth generation. As we saw earlier in our discussion on the activities of demons, demons are heavily involved in the area of idolatry, and encourage the worship of idols, and that is the worship of other gods. And because of the connection between idolatry and demonology, occultism therefore can lead to passing on of demonic control to the third and fourth generation. The fifth characteristic is that occultism requires a meditative or a passive state so that demons can operate or take control. And that's why areas like hypnotism and Eastern meditation and drug abuse are so dangerous. And sixthly, occultism creates a strange magnetism that at the same time draws the participant but also scares them. And people are attracted to it and they move into it, but always with some degree of fear and trepidation. These are the six characteristics of the occult. Let's go on to the fourth point concerning occultism, and that is the occult traps. What are the occult traps by which Satan entraps people into the world of the occult and therefore also into demonism? And in dealing with the occult traps, we can subdivide these into three categories. The first category is spiritism. And spiritism, in its basic form, is the consultation with the dead. The consultation with the dead. And this has taken on, in the history of occultism, five main ways, or five main features or forms. Number one, there is physical phenomenon, such as levitation, where the body is lifted, such as apports, APPORTS, which is the transference of objects from one place to another, and by moving one solid through another. Thirdly, you have telekinesis, which is simple movement of objects without having them move through a solid thing. A second form of spiritism is psychic phenomenon. A psychic phenomenon includes spiritualistic visions, automatic writing, which is the writing, the message of a demon, speaking in a trance, materialization, table lifting, tumbler or glass moving, and excursions of the psyche. A third form of spiritism is metaphysical phenomenon, such as apparitions, where you have a vision of a spirit in human form. You have the element of ghosts, which are localized in one place, and you have the things of that have frequently, not that frequently, but here and there have been reported concerning haunted houses. A fourth form of spiritism is magic phenomenon that includes magic persecution, such as the infliction of disease. This form is mentioned in Numbers 22, verses 6 and 7, and Numbers 24, verse 1. And Balaam was involved in this, and Balaam is called Balaam the soothsayer in Joshua 13, verse 22. It also includes magic defense. And the fifth form of spiritism is cultic phenomenon, and this includes spiritualistic cults, spiritism proper, such as necromancy. Necromancy is a rather old form. It was already prevalent in biblical times, and it's mentioned in 1 Samuel 28, verses 3 through 14, 1 Chronicles, chapter 10, verse 13, Isaiah chapter 29, verse 4. So these are the various forms of that first occult trap, which is spiritism. A second occult trap is divination. And divination, in its root meaning, is the foretelling of the future. It does foretell the future. And like spiritism, divination has taken on various forms, at least 11 different forms that we know of, or I should say 10 different forms that we know of. Before mentioning these 10 forms, let's define more clearly what divination means. Divination is the art of obtaining secret, illegitimate knowledge of the future. That is what divination is. The art of obtaining secret, illegitimate knowledge of the future. And there are two different types of divination. First of all, there is augury, or artificial divination, which is the skills in reading and interpreting signs and omens. We find this practice in Ezekiel 21, verse 21. A second type of divination is inspirational divination, which is receiving information through a medium, where a demon speaks to a medium. An example of this is Acts 16, verses 16 through 18. Now, there are key biblical words that are used in the category of divination, and these key biblical words are all in the book of Daniel. They're mentioned in Daniel chapter 1, verse 20, chapter 2, verses 2, 20, 27, chapter 4, verse 7, and chapter 5, verses 11 and 15. And these four are, first, magicians, secondly, enchanters, thirdly, sorcerers or soothsayers, and fourthly, Chaldeans. So these are the key types involved in the area of divination. And divination has taken on, in its history, 10 different forms. Number one, the most popular form is astrology. Still popular today, but it goes back to ancient times. Nobody mentioned. In Deuteronomy 17, verses 2 through 7, 2 Kings 23, verse 5, and Isaiah 47, verses 12 through 13. Also in Jeremiah 10, verse 2, Amos 5, verses 25 through 26, and Acts 7, verses 41 through 43. Secondly, there is cartomancy, which is card-laying and tarot cards practice. Thirdly, there is psychometry, which is trying to determine one's characteristics through the owner's objects. Fourthly, there is palmistry, or palm reading. Fifthly, there is the divining rod, or water witching. Sixthly, there is the rod and the pendulum, which is done on a map to locate hidden objects or persons. Seven, there is prophetic dreams and visions. We already see this in Jeremiah 29, verses 8 and 9. Eighth, the practice of Ouija boards. Ninth, crystal balls. And 10, clairvoyance. And that too is an old form. Already mentioned in Genesis 44, verse 5, and Isaiah 47, verse 9. And so a second major occult trap is that of divination. The third major area of occult traps is magic or sorcery. And what we mean by magic or sorcery is the bringing about results beyond man's power through the enlistment of supernatural agencies. It is the actual use of demons to bring about supernatural results. And this too has taken on a number of forms, at least 13 that we know about. There is black magic, which claims to use the forces of evil or Satan. There's also what is called white magic, which says they use the forces of good or God. Actually, both black and white magic are of Satan. Thirdly, there is natural magic, which uses the forces of nature. Fourthly, there is mental suggestion, which is transference of thoughts from one mind to another. Fifthly, there is criminal hypnosis. Sixthly, magical mesmerism, which is healing by touching. Criminal hypnosis, by the way, is hypnotizing someone to do something evil. Seventhly, there is healing magic. Eighth, there is the love and hate magic, the love and hate potions. Ninth, there is the execration cursing, in which you practice a specific curse upon someone that will come to pass, such as the voodoo doll. 10, there is the fertility charms. 11, there is the binding and loosing. 12, there is the death magic. And 13, there is the wearing of amulets to ward off bad luck type things. And that too is a rather ancient practice. It's already found in Genesis 35, verse 4, Judges 8, verses 21 and 26, and Isaiah chapter 3, verse 18. The fifth point to make about the occult world is that the Bible clearly prohibits any contact with the occult, and the Bible strictly forbids believers to be involved. And you'll find such prohibitions throughout the scriptures. It's found in Exodus 22, verse 18, Leviticus chapter 19, verses 26 and 31, Leviticus 20, verses 6 and 27, Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 9 through 14, 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 23, 2 Kings 21, verse 6, Isaiah chapter 8, verse 19, Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 8 and 9, Micah chapter 5, verse 12, and Acts 19, verses 18 through 20. In spite of all of these clear prohibitions, nevertheless, sixthly, practice of sorcery was rather popular in biblical times throughout biblical history. And we see the practice of sorcery in Genesis 41, verse 8, Exodus 7, verse 11, in 2 Kings 9, verse 22, 17, verse 17, 23, verse 24. We see it in 2 Chronicles 33, verse 6, in Isaiah chapter 19, verse 3, in Jeremiah 27, verses 9 and 10, in Ezekiel 21, 21, several times in the book of Daniel, in chapter 1, verse 20, chapter 2, verses 2 and 27, chapter 4, verse 7, chapter 5, verse 11, in Nahum chapter 3, verse 4, in Malachi 3, verse 5, in Matthew 7, verses 22 and 23, in Acts 8, verses 9 through 11, Acts 13, verses 6 through 11, and chapter 19, verse 19, Galatians 5:20, and 2 Timothy 3, verse 8. The Bible records a heavy practice of sorcery, but it clearly forbids believers to have any contact with the occult world.